Here is another star formation region, IC 1396, which includes an interesting area called the Elephant's Trunk. As the stars radiate and deteriorate the gas and dust around them, it carves out these beautiful structures that you see. And this is one, and this one is the one that is referred to as the Elephant Trunk. And this third star formation area is a very interesting one, actually, because if you have an area where stars are forming, it's also an area where stars are collapsing. So all of these sort of wispy, ring-like structures are left over from supernovas, stars that are, you know, were destroyed when they collapsed and sent out shock waves into the interstellar medium. That material from the shock wave has become incorporated into, they did an in-depth study of this particular area, and they have found 33 massive stars that are at the very end of their formation. So these stars that are now forming are incorporating materials from the supernovas that happened in their neighborhood. And when you have cooling remnants like this from old supernova events, that's where PAHs form, the polycyclic aromatic hydrocarbons. And when those become incorporated in stars, and those stars then form and become real stars, and they form a planetary system around them, those are the compounds that will help produce an Earth-like planetary object or system around them. So they are important. The first star we have is Delta Cep, and Delta Cep is a Cepheid variable star. It is actually a binary star system. It has a companion. The Delta Cep itself is the prototype of all Cepheid variable stars. It is in the constellation of Cepheus, which normally is in a dark part of the sky. It's a circumpolar in the northern hemisphere. This particular image, though, is optical and infrared, so you see a lot more stars than you would normally see than if you just went out and looked up yourself. Delta Cep is this particular star right here, and all of these other major stars in the constellation of Cepheus, they all have an apparent magnitude, or how bright they appear to be from Earth. Delta Cep also has an apparent magnitude, but it changes. It actually, Delta Cep is expanding and contracting in a very regular way. That's the definition of a Cepheid variable. It has a very, very nice periodicity that's quite uniform. That will be important later on, because that can be used to determine distances to faraway galaxies. And if you go out in the night sky and you look up and you look at the comparison stars, these two comparison stars right next to Delta Cep, they sort of are at the maximum and minimum variation that Delta Cep goes through. So you could go out at night, and this is explained on the AAVSO website in the Variable Star Astronomy section there in Chapter 7, page 10, tells you how you can go out at night and look up and record the changing magnitude of Delta Cep. So if you went out every night and did that, and then plotted the variation in brightness that you estimated over time using the comparison stars, then you could plot what is called a light curve. From the light curve, which is a plot of brightness over time, you can see that it has a period, and you can measure from one maximum to the next, or one minimum to the next, and you can determine the period, which will be used to calculate the distances to other galaxies. The HR diagram that you, I'm sure, are familiar with by now, the Hertzsprung-Russell diagram, is a scatter plot of absolute magnitude or luminosity versus temperature or stellar classification. When you plot a star on the HR diagram, you know pretty much everything there is to know about that star. You know its age, its temperature, its chemical composition. You know its evolutionary history. It's sort of like the periodic table of the elements in chemistry. Once you understand the periodic table, then you can just look at any element on that periodic table, and you know everything there is to know about that one particular element. So the HR diagram is sort of like the periodic table of the stars. There is an area on here called the Cepheid instability strip. Now, this line here is the main sequence where all normal stars reside. If hydrogen is being fused to helium in the core of a star, they're a main sequence star. Then when they start to evolve, which depends upon their age, how they go through an evolutionary sequence, they can evolve up to the giant branch. They can end up as a white dwarf stellar core. That was on this year's event in Orlando, was all about type 1A supernova events. So everything was related to the giant branch and the main sequence branch and the white dwarf branch. This year, we're more concerned with more massive stars that are evolving horizontally from the main sequence over to the supergiant branch. And as some of these stars move through certain areas on the HR diagram, they start to pulsate in a very periodic way, and they become a Cepheid variable star. And it is in about this area, and that is the light curve for Delta Cep. Another star this year is Alpha Orionis. That is an actual image of the surface of Alpha Orionis, a red supergiant, which is getting close to the end of it, and it will undergo a core collapse fairly soon, astronomically speaking. Antares, again, here we are in the Rho Orpheuci cloud complex star formation region, and now you see Rho Orpheuci is quote up, and Antares is down here. This is M4, which is a globular cluster, not part of the complex at all. Here is a more close-up image of Alpha Scorpii in Antares, and again, M4, the globular cluster. V838 Mon is a very interesting red giant. In 2002, that star came from total obscurity to the brightest object in the entire Milky Way galaxy. And so it was sort of a mystery star for a while. It has now been determined that V838 Mon is a red supergiant. It started off in the main sequence as an F, more massive F spectral class star. So for some unknown reason, this star went through an entire stage from evolving from the main sequence to the super red giant branch in a matter of months, where normally it takes a star from hundreds to thousands of years to go through that process. So it was a very accelerated one. There's still a lot of unknowns about V838 Mon, and if you go to the AAVSO website and look at the variable star of the season archive, V838 Mon is listed under miscellaneous. WR136 is a Wolf-Rayet star. Now, Wolf-Rayet star is a very massive, highly evolved star that it's pretty much gone through the red supergiant stage, and it gets to a point at the very end where strong stellar winds develop on the surface of the star and starts pushing all of the outer atmospheric material away from the star into a nebula around it. And this is a very unstable, very close to the end of collapse star. Here is another image of a Wolf-Rayet star. This is a Hubble image close up of this particular region right here to give you an idea how different it can look in a different wavelength. Here is a Chandra image. So this is an X-ray image of part of it. So you can see what it looks like in X-ray. And this is an infrared, mostly infrared image of the same object. So you can see how different it looks in different wavelengths. So make sure that you collect several different images of each one of these deep sky objects to cover all the different wavelengths.